Have a pretty good community of users, like thousands of users are using DVC, and we have built a company around around DVC, which is called Iterative. We build DVC. We work on CML, continuous machine learning, which is kind of CI/CD for machine learning, and also some commercial offering as well. So a lot of projects and a lot of activities in this like MLOps space. Originally I'm from Russia, from a rural part in Siberia, but I was kind of moving constantly on to the south, from the north to the south, first inside Russia, then Seattle, now Silicon Valley. Doing the startup in Silicon Valley is kind of a natural thing. Any activity becomes a startup in Silicon Valley. This is how it works here. Today we are going to talk about DVC, data version control, and data ops in general. Data ops, it's a very, I would say, broad area, and any AI platform, any automation around machine learning needs this data ops part. As a DVC, we are building this open DevOps platform, right? DVC, it's open kind of a tool for DevOps. And I will explain what DevOps is about and why it's important to have this like an open solution for data ops. So probably I can, it's better to share my slide. I have some slides. Would you mind?
Yeah, sure, Dmitry, please go ahead.
One second, let me share my desktop. Background, about my background. I was at academia about like 10 plus years ago, and I joined Microsoft as a data scientist about maybe 7-9 years ago. I was working on Bincats on at Relevance team when I saw how machine learning looks like in large organizations, and it was a My first surprise was how it differs from academia, and this was, I would say, expected, because in a big organization you're supposed to have predictable process, right, around machine learning, around models, it was great to see how the company organizes workflow and practices around machine learning models. What I didn't expect, how machine learning is different from software engineering, because before I was pretty sure that it's more or less the same thing. When I work in a large organization, I have seen how they built automation around machine learning, and I learned it's a different. And Microsoft built like a special AI platform to support machine learning process, and it was a surprise for me at that time. And I start thinking, all right, this like a large companies build like a nice AI platforms, and Microsoft not the only company which has an AI platform, right? And my question was, but how about the future? What kinds of how this AI platform should look like in the future? Should it be the same as we have like these platforms at Microsoft and Netflix and other big companies, or it should be different? And when I start thinking about this, I come up with a few principles which I believe should new AI platform should support. First of all, let me, 1 second. Yeah. First of all, I believe AI platforms of the future should be based on set of tools. I don't believe it will be like one single platform as we use today in large companies. I believe that different types of tool will be combined into some tool set, and people will be like picking and choosing different tools to automate their workflow. I'm talking about like data labeling tool, data ops tool, data orchestration tool, monitoring, model monitoring, and stuff like this, right? The same software engineering works, right? We don't have like software developing platforms, right? We have a bunch of tools, and we can just like change them together to automate our workflow. And each team has a good reason to do this in its own way. I believe the same thing will happen in software in AI. We will have like a bunch of tools and we will be combining them together. And another belief is I don't think that we need to create two separate stacks, one for AI and another one for software engineering. First of all, it's economically not efficient because you're supposed to support like two different teams, right? Two DevOps teams, like one for machine learning and one for software engineering. And this is pretty much what happens today in many companies. They have like two different teams to support the processes. And that's not okay. That shouldn't happen this way. I believe that the AI platform should be based on the software engineering stack. Today we have a bunch of tools in software engineering, version control, code quality control, different linters, CI/CD systems, and all the other tools. And I believe we just need to add a few more building blocks to this ecosystem to enable this like AI platform functionality. And those were the ideas behind DVC. Let's build a tool set which just augments software engineering technology, software engineering stack, which extends software engineering tools, and we still can use the same GitHub, GitLab for collaboration, the same issue trackers, the same CI/CD systems, and maybe even some other tools. So this was kind of the intuition behind the project. And today it's intuition behind the company, because today we are building DVC, which extends Git, right? And CML, which extends like GitHub Actions or GitLab CI. So this is a high level idea to extend set of software engineering tools and support the practice. Engineering practices. Of course, there are more tools in machine learning, like very specific for machine learning, like data labeling, model deployment, and etc. Those three pieces, like versioning, orchestrating resources through like CI/CD, and collaboration for people, it's kind of the core piece of your processes. When you start automation, when you start doing some MLOps work, you will easily find that it's really hard to automate any particular process without managing data. So data is kind of become a big pain when you start, for example, provisioning hardware in the cloud. The first question is like how to transfer data properly. Not a problem at all, right? But when you have like multiple versions, then it's kind of become a problem because sometimes you forget to sync data model back and you need to retrain it. Sometimes you have like eight different version of data set and you forget which one was used for train particular model. If you generated some set of metrics, again, you need to clearly combine all those pieces together, like metrics with code with data, and you need to remember like how exactly which versions were used. So data versioning and data transferring is kind of like core piece behind like any automation around machine learning. This is conclusion I come up with when I start automating different parts of ML processes. But what does it mean, data versioning and data operations? First is how to version data. Second, transfer data. Transferring is also like a big pain point, especially when you go to 10 gigabyte plus scale. And one more interesting part is metrics, because when you talk about data apps, for data, it's not a file. Data is something more than file. People usually associate some metrics with data models, and this is actually how you navigate, right? So what is different between this data set and this data set, right? And the answer is it's not like it has more files, right? The usual answer is the distribution was changed. We added like a new labels, more images with this particular label, right? Some labeling distribution was changed, or maybe like median was changed. We added more interesting samples. So metrics score part, yeah, is core part and need to be also be part of the data ops. And the last part, we need to connect all these pieces together, right? It's not enough to have versions of data, versions of code, versions, and then transfer them all around the cloud. You need to be careful and rigorous about this process. So for DVC, as I said, the idea is to have this tool, have this data ops ability on top of software engineering stack, which means on top of Git. We don't want to reinvent Git. We'd like to use Git and Git capabilities. But how to do this? There are different ways of doing this, but we use the concept of data as a code. You're probably familiar with the concept of infrastructure as a code, right? When we put infrastructure in form of some meta files and provide set of commands to kind of execute this meta file to change your configuration in the state that was codified in the meta files. We use the same idea in DVC. So DVC just creates meta files with description of your data, models, metrics, and the way to transfer the data and or way from transfer the data. And we store this information into Git, right? And then DVC provides just a set of command to operate with this meta information. Pull, push, diff on metrics, build like show plots or something like this. This is simple, not simple, but kind of a general design pattern to work with infrastructure. When I started project, I didn't know about this pattern. We just kind of somehow come up with this idea, but now it's clear that we are using this data as a code concept in DVC. So let's start with this functionality, right? What we can do with DVC. First of all, versioning, which means how to connect, how to get data to your project. For this, we introduce a set of commands kind of similar to Git commands, right? DVC add, it's kind of the same, works the same way as Git add. And we create meta file, like in this case, images.dvc, and commit, and Git commit can kind of fix this result in your repository, so everyone will know how to use. And do you see my terminal? I can quickly show how it works.
Yeah, we can see your terminal.
Let me make it a little bit bigger. One second. So I'm at some repository, and how we codify data, it's you just copy, you just get your data. Images. So we get data to, in a repository, right? Where is it? Images here. Oh, yeah, yeah. So we got train images and validation images. Yeah. Here it is. So what you do, like how to use DVC, you just say DVC add train, and it creates all the meta files. First of all, it creates, it creates meta files and put data in some, in data cache. It's kind of in internal structure, but your data didn't change. You still see the same images on the same place from your code. You work with data the same way as you usually do, right? You just say, hey, file open, this is the name, and that's it, right? So DVC works the same way as Git. It preserves your workspace. It doesn't change anything in your workspace. So DVC train, this file is a meta file. You can take a look at the train. Train DVC. And it has kind of nothing, just a pointer to some information. This is the file which contains the meta information about this directory. And you can actually find this file. We can go a little bit deeper in this demo, right? But you can ask questions. In cache, you can find this file, and this file contains more information about other files inside directory. For example, we have this cat1 JPEG file in directory cat, and this is checksum, and the second file and the third file, and so far and so on. So all the information is presented or data in your cache, but meta information in your DVC. So to work with this trained data, well, you're supposed to add trained DVC in your Git repository, committed, and then you will have this in the repo. When your teammate clones the repository, he or she just can say DVC pool. And DVC pool brings all the data to the machine you need. And it will support all the workspace, right? So you had a file, train cats 1.jpg, right? And your teammates will have absolutely the same file, absolutely with the same path. So it's how to get file. The next question is transferring file, right? We covered this a little bit, and you just use DVC pull, DVC push to move the data around. To move the data, how teammate can get the same data as you and use it from the code. Or maybe you work in Jupyter Hub, and when you start training, you pull data through DVC pool, bring data there, and start working. When you need to fix your result, you do push, you update your model or other data artifacts, and data will be kind of synchronized with the data storage. So the next question, and more interesting one, is metrics. Metrics is something new and not kind of, it might be not even clear that why do you need metrics in data project, but actually it's very important to have association between data and your metrics, because this is how you navigate in your project. Otherwise, you won't be able to answer like a simple question like, all right, I have 5 versions of my model. I have to find what model do I actually need. Looking by code difference kind of doesn't make sense. Sometimes code difference is very small, like one line change or one hyperparameter change. What you really need, you need to look at metrics. You need to look at metrics and how metrics changed in history of your work. Let me show you some examples with the metrics as well. Let me remove these parts. We won't using this right now. All right. All right, clearly repository. So with DVC, we have commands like metrics div. For example, you can take a look what was how your metrics changed comparing to, let's say, 2 commits back, right? And this is the result. 2 commits back, you had metrics accuracy, which was 7% less than you have on the master branch. The same you can do with different, for example, I have branch. Test B, and you can compare metrics with a test B. So in a test B, result is 7%. Oh yeah, here is the result of 7%, almost 7% better than in test B. So when you see these numbers, only now you probably need to know like what exactly was changed, right? So before you see metrics, doesn't make sense to see difference in the code. But once you see the metrics, then the next question would be, all right, but how about what exactly changed, right? And this is a good time to run Git diff or maybe some other different tools to kind of understand what happens. We also have functionality like plots. Why not test B, right? Plots diff, when you can take a look at the difference with in the plots. File diff, and let's take a look at head as well. So this is difference with the head minus two, and this is the difference between head and test B branch. And also you can take a look at the parameters diff. This is about hyperparameters. So two commits back in the master branch, number of feature set was smaller, and we used unigram, and now we are using bigrams, right? So this is what you see from the parameters. You can go deeper, you can take a look at the difference in the code using usual Git commands. But the point is, first you have metrics, and you can start looking at the metrics, and once you know exactly what happens, what was the result of your training, then it's a time to go deeper and look at plots, look at data, code diff, look at data diff, but metrics goes first. So how metrics are represented, it's also very simple format. We just support JSON and YAML files, any metrics file is YAML file. Plot files are also YAML and or JSON. So this is the metric file. It's a that simple, only one value, which is usually not the case. Usually we have like at least like three metrics. And the plot is PRC. It's also JSON, but the JSON is supposed to be with kind of a list of values, not scalars. So what is the presentation? Metrics is the must have part of this data ops functionality in your repositories, in your projects. And Git connects everything together. Right, with the Git, you fix your version of the data, your meta files. You fix your metrics like JSON files, and the rest of the command goes on top. Right, DVC can give you like diff between the branches, between the changes, and data transferring capability. So why it's important to have an open ecosystem of the tool? Why it's important to have an open tool for data ops? First of all, because people can use this as a building block for their automation, and this is how good portion of people use DVC. It becomes like a building block of their AI platforms, their AI tools. Second, if you work on top of existing software engineering infrastructure, you can get benefits from the existing tools, right? So for example, your Git repository, you can look at this repository through GitHub and see all the meta files. You can kind of have some basic navigation. It already gives you like some basic navigation on your projects. And you can easily integrate the stuff, your ML models in other tools like CI/CD systems. This is example of CML project that we have built. CML project, it's a relatively simple library, which gives you like some set of commands to run on CI/CD and get data to the CI/CD pipelines and generate nice reports with metrics and plots. So DVC plays a crucial role in this CI/CD FOML ecosystem. It's usually used as a protocol how to get data to your CI runner, right? And when CI runner is done, some training maybe happens, or you derive some metrics, inference happens. DVC is usually used to preserve the result, to push this result to some storage. A lot of people here are from ThoughtWorks, right? One of the most famous blog posts about CI/CD for machine learning was released by ThoughtWorks about like a year ago, I think. And they also use DVC under the hood, right? It's kind of, today it's very natural way to do CI/CD when DVC just play a role of this building block. This is example of metrics. So I show you the metrics, right, from YAML files, from JSON files in this case. This is how you can easily get the files to CI/CD, to your reports, CI/CD reports. You just run metrics div with compare different branches and output in a MD format to the report and just generate the report from CI/CD. So the same experience as we have in command line, you have right here in your CI/CD tool. So that's pretty much it about this talk. We are working on this open set of tools, DVC, CML, and really believe that this is important to have set of open tools to build your ML infrastructure, your ML automation.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Dimitri. Does anyone have any questions for Dimitri? You can either type them in the chat window and we can ask Dimitri to try and answer them. Or I think you can even unmute yourself if you like, if you've got a question you want to ask directly.
Let me find chat.
Well, why don't I throw in a question to start with? One of the things I'm curious about is I can see how this works really well when you have your data files are on a disk and you can go and use DVC to calculate your checksums and that kind of stuff. But in some cases, you know, data is still caught up inside database engines like a Redshift or a Snowflake or a Oracle or whatever. And how could we turn around and start to use data version control or whatever to understand, you know, what the state is of those data sources that are in those other systems?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And it's kind of like a question about like design of this AI workflow, AI system in general. We designed DVC specifically for machine learning use cases. And in machine learning, how it usually works, it happens on a single machine. So what does it mean? It means even if your data lives in databases, sooner or later you will leave database and start training directly or first data processing content training, right? When you leave the database, it's a time when start versioning, when you're supposed to start using DVC. So you run some query, you commit your query to repository, get the result, and commit and version the result of this query, and then start your local processing and ML training.
Sure, yeah. So I think the answer to that was you can really use DVC as a part of that staging process when you pull that data
exactly,
out.
Exactly.
Yep, that's sort of the point where you can start to say we've now got data that has a certain fingerprint or checksum or whatever, and then that's what was used to build this particular model or code at this particular point in time. So capture it at that point when it's sort of staged. Oh, thanks for that.
Right.
Does anyone else have a question?
Yes, I've got a question. So I'm wondering if there's any way or anything that you offer to make it easier to do like a multi-stage build where, you know, data is derived from other data and there might be multiple stages, just like a Docker file. You may not want to build from the first layer. You may have like the first four layers may not have changed and only the last layer might have a change. So you only want to rebuild that last bit. Is there anything that you do to make that easy?
Like, are you talking about like pipelines, something like pipelines?
Yes, if I have if I have a dependency on a specific version of a data set, but I don't have that locally, but I might have something that that data can be derived from locally, and then I only want to rerun the last step. I don't want to rebuild it from five layers up.
Mm-hmm. First of all, DVC has a concept of pipelines, right? And in DVC, you can construct. It's not only about like capturing data. You also can version the pipelines steps. Like, how do you like process pipelines? Let me show you. Okay. So DVC YAML is usually represents the pipeline. So this is an example of pipeline stages. First stage is prepare. Second is featureize, and the only third step is train. And then there is one more step, evaluate the training result. So this is a usual pipeline. You can think about this as a make file, just like a bit ML specific and data specific. Command is here. This is what you do. Dependencies. If you use parameters, DVC can like understand this, and the output, right? So this is a preparation step. Then you extract features and generate matrices, and only after this you train and evaluate result and get the actual scores and the plot that I showed you before. In some cases, you don't need all the steps, right? For example, if your teammate working on only on ML training, he or she doesn't need result of, first of all, doesn't need original data set, right? And doesn't need the, doesn't need the original data set, but needs only the matrices. Right, process data set. In this case, yes, when you clone the repository, you just clone the right version of the matrices, and that's it. In this case, you kind of save time on data transferring and space.
Okay, so does it do that automatically? So if it recognizes that in this example, only my train.py has changed, and I've got the output from the previous step either locally or maybe in some sort of centralized repository, then it'll just it won't rebuild it from the start. It'll just start from the train stage.
This is the idea of pipelines to understand this what is happening, right?
Yep.
If you change your training script, of course it will recognize the training script was changed. Then I need to retrain the model and evaluate the model, but processing is not needed.
Cool. All right. Great. Thanks.
Yeah, but on Svea, in the data engineering meetup, I think it's important to distinguish this difference between the DVC pipeline that we have here, right, in this file, and data engineering pipelines. So those concepts are a little bit different. DVC pipeline is about machine learning and training. It's not replacement for like Airflow or something. It's two different pipelines, and this is a design pattern that I learned also in a big company. So Microsoft has a special pipelining tool for ML folks and another pipeline tool for data engineering folks, and they kind of, you can combine them together and reuse one from another, but they're absolutely different thing. Yeah? The same way works infrastructure, for example, in Netflix, they have like Metaflow, right? Kind of for data science specific pipelines, and they have like a regular engineering data engineering pipelining tool set. Mm-hmm. So we kind of follow this design pattern. So we are saying pipelines for ML, it's different, and we support only this but not engineering ones.
Conceptually, like why do they need to be different? Like what's the
This is a great question. Conceptually, priority of the people of ML engineers and data engineers are different. Data engineers, as any engineer, they prioritize performance, they prioritize reliability of the system. Like, and ML tools like MLflow can do, for example, can answer a question like, what should I do if my processing step fails, right? You can come up with some rules like how to mitigate these issues. In ML world, people prioritize agility. They don't care about reliability much. And in many cases, my pipeline fails more often than it doesn't, right? I don't care about reliability, and what I do care about, it's a simple language to define pipeline, simple language to reuse the different pipelines. So it's kind of reliability versus agility. And this is why you need to just design two different systems to prioritize one on another. You cannot do both at the same time.
Great. Thanks very much for that, Dimitri. Do we have any other questions?
Yeah, I've got a question.
Ed, thanks.
Thanks very much for that, Dimitri. That was a great talk. I was fortunate enough to be able to use DVC on a project I was on recently. We were training an ML model. And yeah, we were using both the pipelines and obviously the versioning of DVC that sort of allowed us to do reproducible ML experiments in the cloud, which was great. So my question is, we were using the pre-version 1.0 DVC sort of API, and then 1.0 came out, and then that project's actually wound up. So I haven't had a chance to play around with the 1.0 changes, but it looked like there were some really cool changes that actually addressed a lot of the sort of friction points we had. So that's really cool. And I guess I'm sort of curious, was that a bumpy journey towards, like, because there were some pretty big changes, obviously, towards, you know, having the community and users adopt those changes?
So yeah, DVC 1.0, we had quite a lot of changes and new features, a lot of new features. Just to make sure I understand the question correctly, are you asking like why we need this change in 1.0, or
I mean,
what exactly?
I've read some of the blog posts, so I have a sense of that. I think that would be an interesting thing to talk about. What were some of the motivations for it? But then, as a secondary point, was it hard to go through that changing the API?
Oh yeah, of course. API is really hard question, and we spent a lot of resources just to make sure API is kind of stable, right? And we are not breaking them when we build new features. Why we did the change? Because during the last like year or maybe even more, we collected some like new requirements which required like change in API. So, and we didn't do this change right away, right? Because otherwise you need to like, we'll be changing API every month. So we wait a lot of time, like about a year, to make like one single change instead of like many different breaking changes. So we were waiting a lot of time for this. We changed the version only on May. Like after maybe like a year, when we first this question like arised, should we break API finally because it blocks us? This 1.0 release unblocked many other features. So this is why we have to like do this. First big thing is pipelines. We needed like lightweight, better description of pipelines. This file that I show you, right? This is relatively simple file. In the old DVC, you're supposed to define every single step in a different files. And all the different files contain the checksums inside. Today we separate this. We separate definition of the pipelines and we separate check some sums in the log file. So this is how log file looks like, right? It's quite terrible with this check sums and the stuff. So we separated these two things, one user facing and one kind of technical. So this was one of the primary reasons why we changed APIs. And also we introduced metrics. We used to have metrics, but functionality was not rich enough. And for better functionality, we API change was required. So we broke the API and the metrics as well. But yeah, it's not easy decision, and we were waiting like almost for a year to make it.
Yeah, cool. Thank you. Those changes you mentioned in particular around consolidating into a single YAML file rather than having it sort of distributed around your folder structure, and also removing the hashes from those files, I think were, yeah, in particular things that sounded really good, because we definitely ended up having to hand edit a few DVC files to, like, you know, get with the hashes and things like that. And so, yeah, no, it really cool to see the direction that it went with.
Yeah, there is actually one more functionality that we really need, but we were not able to introduce it without these breaking changes, which is called the run cache. If you're familiar with what does it mean, if you change your pipelines and reproduce the pipeline, we can recognize that, you know, that the same change was happened like three runs before, and we can reconstruct and get result to you like right away. So we have a long history of your runs, and we can recognize that some run was happens, and we can catch this result. Why this is important? We don't use this functionality a lot right now, but this is a prerequisite for experiments. We will be implementing experiments in the next couple months. We will be releasing, actually, they're kind of in the active development. And we will have the concept of kind of lightweight Git commit, if you wish, when you do DVC run. And without committing those results, we'll remember all the state, including like data changes, code changes, and metrics changes. So you can easily like get it back and having this result without commits.
Yeah, cool. That sounds like a pretty useful feature. I'm also super keen to check out CML. I think that offered some of the functionality of what it provides also is sort of, well, friction points we had in that same project. So yeah, keen to check that out. Thanks again.
Yeah, CML, yeah. So this build cache actually helps with CML a bit. It helps you avoid auto commits in the CI part, which many companies do not like. Many people do not like to auto commit. Yeah, thank you.
I have a final question. I think as we move to CML, it may be a little off the DVC topic, but I feel that, I mean, I've not like grilled down into CML a lot, but CML to me looked like more of checking out the differences between two trainings, right? So metrics and all. So isn't there an overlap between DVC and CML?
No. Technically, not really. They're absolutely different products. You can use CML without DVC and DVC without CML. But we see them as just two parts of the same ecosystem. For example, in DVC, we have some functionality which can help with in CML. For example, outputs in MD formats, just because most of the CI systems support MD format in the report. Yeah, but in general, they're kind of different things. Different things, yeah.
Okay. Oh, thank you, Dimitri. We might, if anyone's got any other questions, feel free to put them in the chat window, and Dimitri can try and respond to them. Or you can always post questions after the meeting on the Meetup page, and we can forward them on to Dimitri if he can't see them, and try and respond to them from there. Or I think, yeah, Dimitri had his contact details on the screen there before as well. So before we wrap up the meeting, we wanted to move on to the marketplace and open up the opportunity for people to come and talk about any particular data projects they might be running or working on. If you've got a tool or some technology that you're building and you want some help with it, come and share it with the community.